My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it is good to be here. It is good to join our Loyola House of Studies and Loyola School of Theology communities in giving thanks to God for the 50 years of faithful service to the Church, not only in the Philippines, but also to Asia and other parts of the world. Our celebration of this culminating Eucharist is made more special with the presence of the Bishop of Cubao, who allowed us to talk together and who allowed me to preside. Bishop Angio. He was also a student here. He was a graduate of the Loyola School of Theology. And another alumnus, Bishop Michael Hubert Vergara of the Diocese of Pasig. Of course, we have our distinguished Jesuits, led by the provincial Father Tony Romero, and our other guests here, and most of all, you, the students, the employees of LHS and LST. It is quite intimidating to preach before your former professors. Some of them cannot hear anymore, so I'm a bit relaxed. But some of them are still very shy. But it is good to be part of this culminating activity. We were here last year to open the Golden Jubilee. And yes, we're here again to close the readings for this Sunday's liturgy. Present to us a drama. It's very dramatic, you know, the whole theme of the readings. And they even spell out for us the very drama of salvation history and of our lives as Christian. Who are the characters in the drama? In the first reading from the book of Exodus, we have God, Israel, unfaithful to God, and Moses. God, angry, because the people had forgotten him, had forgotten his great deeds. And with a just anger, God decided, I will consume, I will destroy this people. Then came Moses. Moses did something very simple. He reminded God, but they are your people. How could you destroy your own people? How could you destroy the people that you have liberated? Then something deeper than anger and justice surfaced. God remembered. And he repented. No destruction happened. In the second reading from the first letter of Paul to Timothy, we have Jesus Christ, Paul, and Timothy representing the church. Jesus. He started a community. He fulfilled the prophets and the law. But people like Paul, in their zeal, which he later calls his unbelief, persecuted the followers of Christ. He persecuted the body of Christ. But then Jesus was merciful to him. So merciful that Paul, the worst of sinners, according to his own estimation, now becomes an apostle. An apostle before Timothy and the church, a witness to what the patience of God could do. Paul was not destroyed. In fact, he is the vessel of God's word. Then the gospel, all too familiar to us, the three parables of mercy. We have Jesus and the tax collectors and sinners, and the third character, the Pharisees and the scribes. Jesus eating, mingling with sinners, and that caused the Pharisees and the scribes to murmur, to even question the sanctity of this teacher, Jesus. But through three parables, Jesus presented the image of God. And this is the whole drama. In the three readings, the question is, who is God? Do we really know God? Who is the God that we claim we are following? And who are we? Who are we as sinners before the God that Jesus reveals? Let's go back to the three parables. The first parable of the lost sheep begins with Jesus questioning all of us. What man among you, having 100 sheep, will leave the 99 in search of the lost one? He's addressing it to us, not to the Pharisees and the scribes. Who among you will leave the 99 good sheep to look for the one that is lost? Who among you will do that? Probably no one. Or maybe a few crazy ones. I tried it in a Bible study group. I asked them, who among you will leave the 99? No one. No one would leave the 99. Then the next parable. What woman or the women here, the women among you here, losing one coin, will sweep the whole house to search for that one coin when you have 9 other coins? Will any of the women here clean your whole house for that one coin? Maybe not many. Maybe my mother would. But really, that's ridiculous. And then, finding the lost sheep, you call your neighbors to a feast. You find the lost coin, you call your neighbors to celebrate. Oh, this God is overacting. Okay. Sobrang kuha, masyado maarte. And then when we go to the third parable, the lost son, who by the way was also a lost brother to the elder son. He asked for his inheritance, virtually telling the father, I wish you're dead. But since it's taking you time to die, I cannot wait. Give me my share of inheritance. How painful that the father gave him. Wonder that he came to his senses and reversed a line. I am no longer fit to be called your son. Hire me as a servant. That's what I am right now, a servant. But then the father saw him, even from afar, And he broke all conventions, especially the protocol that governed wealthy families. The father left the house, ran to the child, to his lost son, embraced him, literally fell on him. And before the son could even finish the rehearsed lines, the father stopped him. The father would not want him to be reduced to a slave, to a servant, and restored him to the dignity of a son, with the clothing, with the sandals, with the ring. And again, overacting, you had a feast. That's why we sort of understand the reaction of the elder son, who did not feel, by the way, like a son. He described himself as a servant. I labored for you. Naku, kawawa naman siya. Akala natin mabait na anak, pero ang pakiramdam pala niya, alipin na ako. And he refused to join the celebration. Again, who is God? Who is God? In the first reading, it's a God that recoils in his anger because he remembers they are my own. The second reading of Jesus, who trusts someone who has persecuted him in his body, and who goes beyond it, he even entrusts to this persecutor the mission of being his great apostle. And in the gospel, a God who overdoes things. This is not the way to respond to a lost sheep, to a lost coin, to a lost son. And he even lost the elder son, who refused to join the feast. But he got out of the house again and begged the child, the son, to come home. Who is God? And who are we? Who are we? Wow. May sagot niya at sila doon. Salamat na lang sa Diyos na kung minsan din natin maunawaan, tayo ay buhay. Tayo ay may pag-asa pa rin na maging anak. We may be lost. We may be wounded. But we are never absent in God's mind and heart. If we are totally absent, God will not look for us. God will not search for us. We may distance ourselves from God, but we will never disappear from God's mind. And the gospel invites us, the way Jesus invited the Pharisees, those who could not accept this God. Jesus tells them, there is great rejoicing in heaven. Can you not rejoice here on earth with our God? Who is rejoicing in heaven? The Pharisees, the scribes, they are not rejoicing. They are sad that God, through Jesus, lingers are we? Could we rejoice with heaven? Or do we rejoice in our anger, in our sense of righteousness, in our sense of justice? Do we define ourselves in relation to God, the God who has His own ways and His own thoughts, the God who is mystery of fidelity and mercy? But thanks to this God, No one is forgotten. No one is totally lost. You are my own. You are my son. The only reason why God searches, even for the people that the world considers useless, is because it is mine. It is my own. That is our life. And that's the drama of life. Will we rejoice with God? Will we be with God? Or will we choose to be with a God that we fabricate, very different from the God who saves? The God who gives hope, the God who can embrace the wounded, the lost. I would like to say that is precisely the drama of Loyola House of Studies and Loyola School of Theology. For what is formation all about? What does formation consist in? Formation consists in entering the drama. God, you, the world, and the church. What is theology? Theology is a drama where you grapple with the true God. So that as you progress in your theological studies, the idols that you have fabricated, the idols that the world has passed on to us, the idols that even our professors create, would be revealed for what they truly are. They are not the true God. And then with our encounter with the true God, we could witness before the world. After 50 years of dramatic existence, we hope Loyola House of Studies and the Loyola School of Theology will continue participating in the unfolding drama. Sige, sana magkaroon na rin ng Loyola House of Drama. Loyola School of dramatics. Ito yung kailangan ng mundo eh. Yung tunay na drama na sa bandang huli, you know the story. The true God will triumph. And the true God will not even talk about the sin of my lost son. The true God talks only about he was lost. And is found. He was dead and has come back to life. I wonder why the true God speaks this way. What God have we been following and preaching all along? What is the terminology that we use of our concocted, fabricated gods? We pray that the God of mercy may always be compassionate, faithful, to the Loyola House of Studies and the Loyola School of Theology. So that, like St. Paul, these two great institutions will continue boldly to the world of the patience, the love, the forgiveness of the true God. Let us now pause and open our hearts to the God being revealed to us by Jesus. Can we rejoice with God?